I'll just give you an overall idea. These slides are actually more like they describe the system, but they also have some theoretical part. I will skip the theoretical part, but I want to tell you how the system works and what are the different blocks and what are the advantages of OFDM, why it's used a lot in most of the modern wireless communication systems. And then we'll go back to your project. I'll have a discussion with you on the progress report. And then you will have a chance to update your progress report based on today's discussion and submit it until tomorrow, end of day. Okay? So based on the discussions that we'll have today, you will have until the end of day tomorrow to resubmit the progress report for marking. So today only to discuss what you have, obstacles, problems. I know that there are lots of problems. How to move forward, and then you will be able to submit. If you have submitted it already, you can resubmit it again. I'll take the newer version. If you didn't, you will have until end of today, end of tomorrow, to submit the newer version of the progress report. So let's start with OFDM. These are the like the topics. Each one of them is not going to take more than probably a couple of minutes, maybe less than that. We'll skim through them very quickly. I just want to focus mainly on how it works, so the modulation, demodulation, the practical implementation. Once we understand the concept, we will know why it's implemented using IFFT and FFT, and then we will give a quick overlook of the spectrum, which tells us the advantage of the OFDM, how it looks in frequency domain, and then some of the practical considerations again in implementation, which is the cyclic prefix. I'll also talk about that. I will skip the peak power problem. It's not a big issue, but I will just quickly mention what kind of a problem is that. And then we will move to the block diagram that you have in your lab 6, which talks about the overall system that you need to implement. Okay? More or less, by the time we reach this, you will probably be able to explain the block diagram by yourself, because we already go through a block diagram earlier here. Okay? So some of the advantages and the limitations of OFDM, I'm not going to go through all of them, but the most important one is that it's robust against narrowband co-channel interference, which means simply that if you are sending a signal over a very small bandwidth channel, what happens typically is that the bits, when they are going through the channel, they get a little bit spread because of the fact that, okay, if you are sending a bit that looks like this, okay? If you look at this from a frequency domain perspective, it will look something like this. Okay. Okay. So it will have something similar to the sync. It will have some extensions in frequency all the way to infinity. But your channel is band limited, so what will happen is that your channel is going to simply smooth out these things. So it will actually not allow those ripples to happen. If you go back into time and see what happens to your signal due to that, this bit is going to spread all the way to infinity. So basically your bit will get wider. Now the problem is, at the receiver side, you are reading the bit, which is the pulse-shaped bit as we described earlier. You are only reading the middle point, right? Because at the receiver side, this whole thing will come to you. You will sample it at the middle. Okay, to read the value of the bit, or of the symbol, in this case, modulated symbol. Now, this is one. There is a next one which is coming TS time away, right? So the next one will also have the same thing. And then there is a next one, right, which will have also the same thing. The problem is that at this sampling point, those extra tails, they will add up and they will change the value here, which can cause errors at the receiver. This is called inter-symbol interference. One symbol is interfering with the next one, is interfering with the next one. OFDM can overcome this problem, and we will see why. Okay? So that's the major advantage of OFDM. Now, applications of OFDM, this is a list of lots of systems, particularly modern telecommunication systems that are using OFDM. Some of them you already know, for example, 802.11, these Wi-Fi guys, okay? Some of them you have been exposed to them through your assignments, such as the DVB, the digital video broadcast systems, right? Some of them you haven't heard of them before, maybe, WiMAX.
This technology has had a hype and then it disappeared with the appearance of the 3GPP LTE. So LTE, the newer cellular system, is also using UFDM. Okay? But these are, this is a list of several wireless technologies that are using, just for your information, I'll keep it there. Not only wireless, but even some wired communication systems are using OFDM, particularly the ADSL. So you have been exposed to that through your home internet before we get the optical fiber. There is also something called power live communication. So one of the newer trends in telecommunication is that people have thought, okay, we have all of these power outlets, right, which are connected to the power grid, and the power grid goes from one home to the other, right? So we already have connectivity, but we are not using it for communication. So why not use those cables to communicate? And there are particular standards for that. There are techniques. The communication over power lines is also happening using OFDM. Okay? Challenges there are different. The problem there is that those cables are not designed for communication, so they have lots of limitations, so you have to meet those limitations. In addition to that, they carry high power signals, which are the power, the electric power, right? And these signals can cause some nonlinearities, some interference, some issues with your communication signal. So there are different challenges, there are different standards, but still the core is OFDM system, okay? So that's also one of the phase non-wireless, or maybe wired, you can call it wired, communication over power lines. Now, even though this looks mathematical, but I will still go through it. Sorry. I'll just, because I'm lots of 10, so I'll just disable this thing. Okay, so this description, to simplify it or quickly describe it, what it talks about is, okay, I have, this is the OFDM modulated signal, okay? Right? And it's composed of symbols. Those are symbols that comes out of your modulator, out of your mapper, right? Which are multiplied by, these are simply cosine functions, okay? E to the j omega t is a cosine omega t plus j sine omega t, right? So you can think of these as simply cosine functions, right? So as if you have different symbols coming out of your modulator, that's the basic concept. You have different symbols coming out of your modulator, right? The mapper, okay? Symbol at time one, symbol at time two, symbol at time three, and then each one of them is multiplied by a different frequency, okay? Those frequencies, we call them sub-channels or sub-frequencies or sub-carriers. So my total system coming out of this, which is the summation that we see here, is all going to be carried over a carrier, for example, at 2.4, okay? At that 2.4 carrier, so my total, this does not show you as a carrier, okay?
Each symbol would be multiplied by different frequencies?
By different frequency. That's called sub-channels. I'm just going to describe this, okay? So all of this, which is what we call S of T, okay? Think of it as some signal that will have some bandwidth, right? Starting with the first carrier, ending with the last carrier, right? And there are in-between carriers, okay? Each one of those carriers is carrying a small signal around it, right? Each one of those is carrying a small signal around it, okay? Small signal bandwidth. Okay, because I have some signal S, which has some bandwidth, right, the symbol, and then that symbol is put around the carrier, which we call them subcarriers. The collection of all of these, which is the summation that we see here, right, is going to be those blue things added together, okay? So you will end up with a wider signal, which is the summation. So this whole thing is this whole thing, okay? Now, all of this, you think of it as one collective signal, which is the OFDM signal, and then you put it, you center the whole thing around the actual carrier, 2.4, 5.2, 900 megahertz, whatever, okay? So all of this is eventually going to be put around FC, okay? Now, that's how the signal is composed, okay? So you take different symbols. Okay, in this case, you have, for example, N, capital N, subcarriers. So you will take every n samples that comes to you, okay? You take the first one, put it around a first subcarrier. The second one, put it modulated with a second subcarrier. The third one with a third subcarrier, and so on. These subcarriers are adjacent to each other. What's the separation between them? We will talk about it in a minute, okay? And then all of these will end up being one signal when you add them together, okay? Now you take that signal, you consider it that this is going to be your transmitted signal, you will put it around the larger carrier, okay? Now, the separation between one carrier and the next one is called delta F, okay? And this is called the subcarrier or the intercarrier separation, okay? Delta F. And the symbol duration, you know, the symbol which is coming out of your modulated signal, which is the one that you eventually multiply by a pulse shape, okay? That one, we know already that it has a duration called TS, right? It depends on how many symbols per second you are sending. If I send 1,000 symbols per second, then TS is equal to 1 over 1,000, right? That's the symbol duration, right? The condition for OFDM is that TS multiplied by the subcarrier separation is equal to 1. So basically, if I have a simple duration, symbol duration TS, then it means that my subcarriers, starting at a certain value, right, the next one is going to be equal to the first one multiplied by, added to it, delta F. What's delta F? Delta F is equal to 1 over TS, right? The next one is going to be the first one added to it, 2 delta F. The next one, 3 delta F, and so on. These are the separations between those carriers. So here, this separation between one subcarrier and the next one is what we call delta F, okay? And the condition is that delta F, as I showed it almost more or less on the diagram, this is the symbol duration, right? And delta F, the separation between one and the other, is almost equal to the symbol duration, okay? Again, this was a frequency diagram, but if you look at it from a time perspective, the separation between one and the other is equal to 1 over delta S, over TF, TS, okay? The time between one symbol and the other, okay? Separation is the same, but if you measure it from the first one, يعني من أول واحدة للتانية هيبقى 1 over TS. من أول واحدة للتالتة 2, 3 وهكذا. لكن between any one and the next one is 1 over TS. This is separation in frequency, right? Which is delta F, which is equal to 1 over TS. خلاص؟
This condition was true. We will not have intersample.
We will not. I'll show you why. Okay? So you got the idea? So this is the idea of OFDM. You have multiple smaller subcarriers. Smaller here means that they are small in frequency. They are not the 2.4, right? They are just, let's say for example, if I have a symbol duration 1 microsecond, then my first subcarrier is going to be 1 over TS, right? So 1 over 1 microsecond will give me 1 megahertz. The next one is going to be at 2 megahertz. The next one is going to be at 3 megahertz, and so on. These are going to be my subcarriers, okay? Where each one of them will have a bandwidth equal to 1 megahertz, right? Because that's the separation between one and the other, right? So now, how am I going to do this as a system? I have my symbols coming through after the modulation. Here it says TB, but this should be TS, okay? So I have my symbols coming from the modulation, the mapper, the one that we call it mapper. I convert them, they come serially, right? They come one after the other from the mapper. I have a few bits going into the mapper. It will take, for example, every 2 bits, create from them a symbol. Next 2 bits, a symbol. Next 2 bits, and so on, okay? If I'm using a four array modulation, right? So every 2 bits are going to create one symbol, and they will move on serially, one after the other as data goes through, right? Now what I would do is I would store them into a range of n symbols, okay? And then instead of having them going serially, I will convert them into parallel, okay? So serial to parallel conversion, this one, okay? So I will have n of them, where n is the number of subcarriers that I want to use, okay? Because we want to put them onto different carriers, so we have to do this, okay? So first step is convert them into from serial to parallel. So basically, you have to store n of them and then use them at once. And then store the next n and then use them at once. That's how you do serial to parallel, right? Okay. And then each one of them is going to be multiplied by a different subcarrier. So the first one is going to be multiplied by F1. The next one is going to be multiplied by F2 up to Fn, right? Now, each one of those carriers, how does it relate to the previous one? They are multiples of each other. If the first one is equal to 1 over Ts, right? The second one is separated 1 over Ts, it means the second one is going to be 2 over Ts. The next one, 3 over Ts, and so on. So basically, this is double the first. The next one is double, triple the first. The next one is 4 times the first, and so on, right? Now, if you have subcarriers this way, if you have cosine omega t, cosine 2 omega t, cosine 3 omega t, cosine 4 omega t, right? If you multiply any one of them with the other, what happens? And you integrate, what happens? So cosine omega times cosine k omega, okay? You multiply these two and you integrate over one period, what will you get? Zero, okay? These are called orthogonal frequencies, okay? If I have cosine omega t multiplied by cosine 2 omega t, and I integrate over one period, which is going to be the biggest period is this one, right? Because this is the lower frequency. So the period in this case is 2 pi over omega, and I integrate with respect to time. What will I get if I do this? Cosine times cosine is going to be cosine the sum, cosine the difference, right? Cosine the sum is going to be cosine 3 omega t. When you integrate a cosine over a full period, in this case you are integrating over 3 periods, you will get what?
Zero,
right? And the difference is going to give you cosine omega t. When you integrate a cosine omega t over one period, you will get zero. So the end result of this integral is going to be zero. The only case that the integral is not going to be equal to zero, when it's a cosine omega t times cosine omega t. Right? Because in that case, it will give you what?
Correlation.
It will, yeah, but it will give you what mathematically? Yeah, it's correlation. What we are doing here is correlation, but it will give you what mathematically? Cosine square. Cosine square, you can break it into a DC term, right? One, and then the second term is going to be cosine double the frequency. Right? Cosine double will give you zero under the integration, but the constant term is not going to give you zero, right? So you will end up with a value only if the two cosines are at the same frequency. But if one of them is multiple of the frequency of the other, you will get zero. And I only clear that. So what's happening basically is that I'm sending my signals over omega t, 2 omega, 3 omega, and so on. At the receiver, what do I want to do? I want to separate them, right? Because I'm doing this, adding them together. At the receiver, I want to extract back symbol 1, symbol 2, symbol 3. So what will I do? I will take my signal and pass it through something very similar. So multiply it by F1, F2, up to Fn, right? Now, for symbol 1, when it goes through the receiver side with the same rack, right? All the branches are going to produce zero, except when it's multiplied by F1, right? Right? Because symbol 1 is multiplied by F1 from the transmitter side. Now, when it arrives at the receiver, it will be multiplied by F1, F2, F3, F, right? And each one of them, multiplication and integral, okay? When it's multiplied by F1, it will produce a value. When it's multiplied by F2 or F3 or F0, 0, 0, 0. So I will get what? Over the first branch, only S1, right? Similarly, symbol 2 out of this combination, when it's received, it will go through all the branches. All the branches will produce 0 except the branch that multiplies by F2. So I will get symbol 2 on a different branch, right? And so on. The others will disappear. So I combined them at the transmitter, I made them parallel, and then put them into different subcarriers, added them into one signal. At the receiver, I was able to separate them again into different branches, and then I will do what? Parallel to serial, and then I will get my symbols back, right? That's what we will just mention right now. Okay, that I will just answer this question right now, okay? So the question here, how is this different from typical multiplexing? And the next slide, this different, okay? We said originally that
This shows you, okay, this one shows you the OFDM signal, right? And then when at the receiver you are doing the recovery. So this is the OFDM signal, and then added to it some noise over the channel, and then the recovery at the receiver when you multiply by the subcarriers again, right? And it tells you that the result of this, when you multiply by subcarrier FL, is going to be only signal SL out of all the summation, right? Plus the noise, of course. So the noise will never disappear. It's there, okay? Now, look at the signal, how it's composed, right? It's composed of a factor multiplied by e to the j 2 pi fk t, where the fk's are, let's call them f0, and then 2f0, 3f0, 4f0. What does this look to you like? You remember the Fourier series expansion of a signal?
Yes.
Right? It contains what? It contains some coefficient multiplied by DC term.
Yes.
And then another coefficient multiplied by omega t. Yes. A third coefficient, 2 omega t, 3 omega t, and so on, right? So simply this signal looks like a Fourier series expansion, or a in discrete terms, it looks like a discrete Fourier transform, okay? Now, one of the ways that a discrete Fourier, I don't know if you studied this in your signals and systems or not, but one of the efficient ways of implementation of Fourier transform calculation is something called the FFT, fast Fourier transform. It's just an algorithm that eventually you put the signal from one side, it produces the Fourier transform from the other side, the Fourier series expansion from the other side, right? So since we found out that this is a Fourier series expansion of a signal, S of t, right? Then we can, instead of using multiple multiplications by different carriers, we can simply take our signal S of t, put it through a Fourier transform block, it will produce from the other side this expression, right? So even if I have 1024 subcarriers, I don't have to do much. I just have to take them through a Fourier transform block, which is capable of producing 1024 coefficients, right? So that's why OFDM can be implemented easily, even though it looks originally that I have to do all these subcarriers and so on. Eventually, this is a simple FFT block, which exists in most of your digital systems, right? From typical multiplexing, not. So simply, it ends up that this is the digital communication part that we have studied so far, right? So you have source encoder, encryption, right? And then you go through your channel encoder. Then the last step is that you map the symbols into the bits into symbols, and then you do a serial to parallel conversion, right? And then you do an FFT, and I will tell you why it's IFFT, not FFT, okay? So that FFT will produce from here what? SK multiplied by e to the j omega, right? So that's your OFDM signal, right? It goes to the receiver. The receiver will do a parallel to, It goes through a parallel to serial to add them together, right? To send them as one thing, because you cannot send parallel data over the channel. It's only one channel, right? So back to serial, and then there is one extra thing which is called the guard interval, okay? That's added to your Fourier, your OFDM signal, okay? Now, as we looked at the OFDM signal, we said that it's very nice in terms of combating the inter-symbol interference, right? It allows you actually to act nicely on channels that can cause inter-symbol interference. The problem that OFDM can face, actually, is that if your carriers are drifted a little bit because of mobility, for example, so when you have mobility, what happens is that you have something called the Doppler effect. The carrier that's seen by the receiver is a little bit different from the actual one, based on whether the two transmitter and receiver are becoming closer to each other or moving away from each other, right? And I mentioned that to you earlier, right? Now, if this happens, this could corrupt the orthogonality of the signal, right? When you look at this in practical, what happens simply is that instead of reading those different orthogonal signals at the right place, you will read them shifted a little bit to the right or a little bit to the left, okay? Now, if you have studied this digital signal processing, and particularly discrete Fourier transform, and particularly FFT, you will know that the FFT signal is periodic. When you look at it, it's periodic. When you do a Fourier transform of a discrete signal, you end up with periodic signal in frequency domain, right? So the signal in frequency domain is periodic. Now, a shift to the right or a shift to the left is going to cause you to go into the next period,
But the next period is exactly similar to the current period, right? Now, if you send the signal as it is, and it is shifted, at the receiver, it will be part of it is lost, right? And the other part is filled by some noise, right? Which means you will receive something wrong, okay? But if you send the signal, and you send a repetition, and then it's shifted, you will eventually get one period correctly, as long as the shift is not too much.
Let me explain it to you in a graph, okay? This is your FFT signal, the different subcarriers with the signal, okay? In frequency domain, this would look like this, and then the same thing is repeated again, and the same thing was supposedly repeated before, and so on. But in real implementation, you're only sending this, right? Now, at the receiver, if it does not receive this completely correctly, and the receiver is shifted a little bit to the right or the left, now shift here means movement in frequency, which means a Doppler effect, right? So, if the receiver is not well aligned, and the receiver, for example, receives this part. Now, in practice, if it receives this part with a portion of the next one, right, this portion is exactly the same as the lost one because they are periodic. So everything would be fine. But in practice, you are only sending this. So if it's shifted, it's going to receive this plus some noise here because nothing, right? And it has lost this part, so the signal cannot be recovered. To overcome this, what do? You take this part. You amend it to your signal. So eventually you send what? You send this, right? And assuming that this is the first part, you take it from here, you leave it, I mean, and then you take a copy and you amend it also here, right? Now by doing this, what are you doing? You are allowing some margin for that shift to happen, and you can still, if the shift happens within this block, you can still recover the original signal, right? Because this part, which is lost, is going to be compensated here. And you can recover your original signal. Okay? Even though if they are out of order, it doesn't matter because it's a periodic signal. Right? Okay? So that's called, this part is called a cyclic prefix, or they call it the guard interval insertion. Okay? So they take this, they put it again, so this stays, and then they add it again here. Okay? Now we lose something here because, again, you lost some bandwidth, right? But you have to. Otherwise, with any mobility, your system will not work. Okay? So you got the idea of that. That's another practical aspect of OFDM that you have to take care of.
How much we can insert or cut from the signal?
It's up to you, but it depends on what's the channel characteristics.
But I don't know because the mobility may change.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Okay, typically, for example, this system is going to be used for cars. So cars will require only like 5% maybe. Okay? That's the maximum Doppler that can happen with speeds of cars. This system is going to be used for rockets. These are very fast, maybe 25% that you need to copy and so on. So it depends on the system. Yes, it depends on the system. And it comes as part of the standards. So the standards that are used for Wi-Fi are different from those, because Wi-Fi does not have that much mobility, are different from those used for LTE. It acts with cars and like transportation systems. So it has more mobility. It requires more guard band and so on. Okay. Any other questions? So two important practical aspects of OFDM. Number one, the implementation can be easily done using FFT, and FFT again at the receiver to recover your register. So the receiver is going to do just the inverse of the operation, right? Now why IFFT and here FFT? Because this means as if I have frequency domain and I'm creating time domain signal, and this one, this is inverse Fourier transform, okay? And this one is the other way. And in fact, yes, if you look at the equations, it's e to the j omega t. So e to the j omega t is from frequency to time. And e to the minus j omega t is from time to frequency. That's why we use IFFT in the transmitter, FFT in the receiver. Okay. What was your question?
It was about the frequency and time domain, why we divide the two equations.
Okay. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So that's it in terms of this slide that we end. Okay, this slide, okay? In case of typical multiplexing, you need a separation between one channel and the next channel, so if you use general frequencies, right? What do you want to have? You want to make sure that the bandwidth of the first one does not overlap with the bandwidth of the second one, right? So in this case, the separation here between this point and this point is going to be double the bandwidth of the signal, right? You need to leave a distance between this carrier and this carrier, so F1 and F2,
you need to leave a distance between them equal to this plus this. If we think of the bandwidth as half the bandwidth of the signal, then you need to leave, right, two of that bandwidth, 2B. Part of it is here, part of it is here, right? For OFDM, because of the orthogonality, right, the distance between one and the next one is only 1B, right? So there is an overlap in the bandwidth wise, okay? But how do I overcome this overlap? By the fact that when I'm demodulating, all these guys will disappear and only this one will remain, right? Similarly, for this one, all the others will disappear and only this one remain because of the orthogonality between the different carriers used, right? Here, we are not using orthogonality because it does not exist. We are just using typical FDM multiplexing. Here, we are using orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, right? Orthogonality comes from the fact that each carrier is a multiple of the first carrier, okay? And to make that multiple efficient, it has to be equal to 1 over TS, the difference between the different subcarriers, okay? So that's the game. So you can see that we have saved almost half the bandwidth, okay? As compared to using typical multiplexing. Now that's one game that I was able to put signal over different subcarriers, right? And then eventually use only B. If I wanted to do that without orthogonality, I would use 2B. Okay? If my original signal, all symbols together, will have a bandwidth equal to B, if I use OFDM, I will use a bandwidth B, right? If I use regular FDM, I will have to use a bandwidth 2B, okay? So what's the game? I mean, using OFDM, I still need a bandwidth B to send a signal of bandwidth B. What did I gain, right? If I didn't do any multi-carrier, if I just took the signal as it is, put it in on a carrier, it would have used a bandwidth B, right? If I do subcarriers, if I do them with orthogonality, I will still need B. If I do them blindly without orthogonality, I will actually need 2B, which is a loss. So I will never do this. But why do this while I can just send the signal as it is, and I will use the same bandwidth? Here comes the part which I told you about, which is the gain of doing sub-modulation or sub-carrier modulation, okay? Simply look at it this way. I have this bit, right? And I want to send it over the channel, okay? If I send this bit and the next one immediately after it, right? And then the next one immediately after it, right? So this is at the different times. Okay. So TS, this is 2TS, 3TS, and so on, because they are separated by the symbol or the bit duration. So we use the symbol duration. So TS, TS separation, and so on, okay? And I mentioned to you that if you are using narrow band, if you are using typical transmission channel which has limited bandwidth, right? What will happen is that these guys are going to spread a little bit, right? So this guy also is going to spread a little bit, and this guy is going to spread a little bit, and then inter-symbol interference will happen. Now, I do care about inter-symbol interference only if, after this spreading, the amount at the center of the next bit or the previous bit is high enough such that it will cause errors, right? Okay. Now, if this happens, if the amount is high enough, what do I have to do to overcome inter-symbol interference? I have to separate these guys, yeah. Right? So to make them further. If I make them further, it means TS is going to be larger. Now, typically, without doing OFDM, making TS larger means what? I'm reducing the transmission rate, right? Because instead of sending one, for example, assume TS is 1 microsecond, okay? So instead of sending 2 bits within 1 microsecond, if I make them larger, like 2 microseconds, I will send only 1 bit over 2 microseconds, right? So I've reduced my transmission rate, okay? So reducing transmission rate is not good. It can save you from inter-symbol interference, but means that your system is becoming slower, cannot send data as fast as you want, okay? Now what OFDM is doing is simply, look at what we do at OFDM, okay? So I have this symbol. I have the next one, I have the next one, I have the next one, and so on, okay? On one carrier, on one channel, I'm doing what? I'm taking this guy, assume that I'm going to use 3 subcarriers, okay? So the first subcarrier is going to take this one. So this is on F1. The second subcarrier is going to take this one. So this is going to be on F2. The third subcarrier is taking this one, which is going to be on F3. The fourth guy is going to go where? Back to F1, right? So what happened is that between one bit and the other, what did I do? On the same channel, on the same sub-channel, I made a longer separation, right? So even if this spreads, it will not interfere with this one. Did I reduce the rate? No, because I'm sending this and this and this at the same time. So I'm maintaining the rate, but I'm allowing my bits to spread further without inter-symbol interference. So that's why we do, in general, multi-subcarrier transmission. And to be bandwidth efficient, we select those subcarriers to be orthogonal together. So everyone got the idea. This is a quick description of how OFDM works and why we use OFDM. Any questions in the concept itself? No. Why it will be affected? Actually, here we have more noise.
Yeah.
Because here we are using a wider bandwidth, which means you are collecting more noise. Here we are using the same original signal bandwidth. We did not change, right? So we will not add more noise to the system. Okay. You will end up with this, or they will interfere together, which is going to destroy your signal. Yes, if they are not orthogonal and you don't keep enough separation, then you will not be able to recover the signal again. Yes?
What's the minimum subcarriers? Can we use two instead of three?
You can use whatever you like. It's up to you how much you want to overcome the spreading, right? And then the more subcarriers you add, the more complicated is your system, right? Because multiple carriers, right? Now, remains one thing about practical implementation, because it might look okay. In this case, if I use, for example, which is typical, by the way, a 1024, so 1,024 subcarriers, which happens actually in Wi-Fi. Okay, so they separate the signal into 1,024 subcarriers. Okay, does this mean that I need actually inside my system 1,024 different oscillators to produce those different cosines? That's going to be too much, right? Now, the beauty of OFDM is that it was fast. So the block diagram that you have in your lab 6, which is your project or part of your project, is simply nothing different from the block that I have just described for you, right? So you have the symbol mapping, right? I cannot see what's this, but this is and self-training, yes, okay? So that's something worth describing, okay? Now I mentioned to you earlier, and that's also something which is part of lab 4 and 5, the frame detection and the channel estimation. Okay? I mentioned to you earlier that your signal, as it goes through the channel, it's affected by two things. It's multiplied by some gain factor, which is the effect of the channel, right? And then eventually at the receiver, a noise is added to it. And that reminds me that some of you in the midterm, they express y of t as x of t plus noise, and everything is multiplied by alpha. This is wrong. The alpha is only multiplied by the transmitted signal. The noise is added after the multiplication of the alpha. Okay? So that's one thing to keep in mind again for the future. Noise is the last thing. It's not affected by anything else in the channel. Okay? So anyways, so your signal is multiplied by some gain factor. And then at the receiver, you want to remove that because it's actually an attenuating factor. So it's causing your signal to noise ratio to be very much reduced. You want to overcome that, right? So in order to overcome that, you need to know what was the attenuation factor and then inverse the operation. Now, knowing what was the attenuation factor is called a channel estimation process. Okay. And the way typically channel estimation is implemented, one of the simplest ways, is called pilot-assisted or training symbols-assisted channel estimation. Okay, what happens is within a particular standard, for example, the Wi-Fi, we already know your laptop, the Wi-Fi in your laptop, as well as the Wi-Fi access point itself at manufacturing time
They already know that. At the start of every transmission, there is a set of known symbols that will be thrown into the channel, regardless of the data. We call them training symbols. Okay? So at the start of the transmission of this guy, when it starts transmitting to your laptop, it will send, for example, 10011. Okay? And I know that the 1 should be 5 volts. The 0 should be minus 5 volts, right? So I expect that the first few symbols are going to be 5, minus 5, minus 5, 5, right? Now, as a receiver, the first few ones, instead of that, I receive 3, minus 2, 3, 3, for example. This means what? I was expecting 5, I received 3. So this means what did the channel do? Multiply the data that was coming by 3 over 5. So the channel gain was 3 over 5. I can estimate the channel gain because I know what I expect to receive and I know what I actually receive. The difference is the channel gain. Okay, it's like a multiplicative gain, so it's not subtracted, it's division. Okay? So I can estimate the channel gain, alpha hat, using that training sequence. That's the insert training here. So before sending my OFDM data, I insert part of it, which is pre-agreed with the receiver at manufacturing, so it's something that fits with the standard, right? And every time I send a set, every time slot, I send a set of OFDM symbols, right? The receiver knows that the first few are the training, which has this value. Now I find something different. Using that something different, divide that something different by the actual expected, I can get the estimate of the channel gain. And then what do? Cancel that by doing what? Multiply the remaining data with the inverse of that, right? So my data will come into two pieces, right?
The first piece is called training, right? And then the next piece is my data, okay? At the receiver, what I do is I take, now through that channel, what I will receive is alpha, the channel gain multiplied by training. And this is received. Okay? But at the receiver, I'm expecting T. Right? So channel estimate must be equal to what? Alpha T divided by T that I know already, which is going to be alpha. Now, the data also is going to be multiplied by alpha because it's coming through the same channel, right? I want to cancel that. What should I do? Whatever I got from this operation, I'm going to inverse it and multiply it by the data, right? By the received data. So that's called equalization because what I did is I canceled this, so I returned the data to its to be equal to what was transmitted originally, right? It's called the equalization process. So these processes come together always. There is estimation followed by equalization, okay? So what I would do is in equalization, I'll just say 1 over alpha multiplied by the data, which is alpha times data, right? To get eventually data, right? That's called the equalization process, yes?
So every frame. So we have data divided into frames. Let's say the frame, for example, is 2 microseconds. So every 2 microseconds, I expect to have a part which is doing channel estimation data. And then after that, another 2 seconds, 2 microseconds, the first part is going to be training and then data and so on. Why? Because the channel is not constant. It's randomly changing. So I cannot estimate it once and stop, right? So I have to follow the channel. So, for example, for this guy, I think it's 1.8 and 1.7 microseconds. You can look it up in the standard. So every 1.7 microseconds, you get a new channel estimate. Okay?
Any other questions? So the rest is what you have seen already. So the serial to parallel, the FFT.
Null tones are basically,
if you have some of the subcarriers, because that happens actually in OFDM systems, sometimes you decide that you are not going to use all the subcarriers. So basically these are the null tones. These are some of the subcarriers that you are not using them for transmission. Why? Because sometimes you have what's called OFDMA. So you have OFDM from one unit, another OFDM from another unit sent at the same time, but they are using different subcarriers within the total set of subcarriers. So if I have 1024, one of them is going to use 512, the other one is going to use the other 512, right? So the first one must insert nulls in those not used. The second one will use them and insert nulls in the other ones. So that's called the null insertion. It just sets the unused to zero such that they don't interfere with the other one. Okay. Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Very large time. During this training, we would have disconnect from the data remote or what?
During this training, what will happen?
I mean, it's 0.1 microseconds, very fast. If we make, for example, half an hour, imagine like this, we will have disconnect, we will be disconnected from the data or what?
No, you mean I don't estimate the channel frequently? That's what you're saying?
Yes.
So what will happen is that you will have lots of errors because the data is going to be fluctuating and your signal-to-noise ratio is going to be very much reduced.
I will be connected to the channel. I will get
data
or wrong
data. Yeah, we'll get errors. So, I mean, typically the system will show you errors and then it will try to reduce the modulation, it will try to play around to overcome this.
I thought
you
would have this connecting.
It can reach up to the level that it will just say this because, again, for the system to know it's connected or not, there is part of the data which is used as control, right? And that part happens periodically. If at one point I start losing those, I will just say disconnected. The Wi-Fi will disappear. You will not see the node in your list of nodes, right?
Doctor, could you please repeat the channel estimation? I didn't understand.
The whole thing? Okay. So, okay, you want the receiver to know ahead of time what was the channel gain. Okay? So if I am sending you, for example, okay, let's say this. Okay, if I'm using, خلينا ناخد example من الحياة الطبيعية. خلاص. افترض إن أنا عندي مثلاً boy بتاع مراسلة وببعته مثلاً أنت في مكتب وأنا في مكتب في الشغل كويس وببعته بالجوابات لي. وبعدين at some point in time we started untrusting this guy. No, we don't know whether he is. ببعته مثلاً مثلاً في ميزانية بنظبطها وأنا ببعته بشوية فلوس عشان تحطيهم في الميزانية وأنت بترجعي معاه شوية فلوس وإحنا we are not trusting this guy. So what's the best way to know whether he's affecting the money اللي بتتبعت معاه ولا لا؟ أكون متفق معاكي إن أنا هبعت لك 50 ريال وديهم لي تمام؟ لما يوصلوا لك 30 تعرفي إن هو بيسرق 20 صح؟ That's simply that's what I do in the training part. I already agreed with the receiver that I will send you some data T معروفة تمام؟ هو بقى لما بيستقبلها بتطلع حاجة تانية. والإكسبكتد إفكت أوف ذا شانل إنها whatever was sent over it, that channel multiplied it by a factor. تمام؟ يبقى أنا عرفت الفاكتور ده على طول ولا لأ؟ أنا عارف المفروض أستقبل إيه؟ وعارف اللي استقبلته، اللي هو مش اللي المفروض أستقبله. الحاصل اسم ده على ده يديني الإفكت على الشانل، صح؟ Which was originally unknown to the receiver but now it became known. صح؟ Now it's the same channel used to carry the training as well as the data. يبقى لو انا عرفت ان التريننج مضروب في الفا يبقى اكيد الداتا كمان مضروبه في الفا لان دول التريننج ودول الست اللي ببعتهم كلهم مع بعض مره واحده تمام. So I know that my data is multiplied by alpha. I want to cancel this alpha. What do I do? Multiply by 1 على alpha. خلاص. So the first part knowing the alpha through the training is called estimation. The second part اللي هو multiply the data 1 على alpha اللي انا already عرفتها is called equalization.
طيب على كل سب كارير
رح نضربها بألفا غير على no. We don't deal with sub carriers here. We deal with one OFDM set مع بعضها. لأن ما يهمنيش السب كارير لأن يهمني التايم.
يعني الست هاي كلها مضروبة في ألفا واحدة.
في ألفا واحدة بالضبط. لأن أنا عملت إيه؟ مش خدتهم أنا سيريال تو بارلل وبعدين بعتهم كلهم مع بعض أز وان بلوك اللي هو OFDM سيمبل؟ اه بالضبط تمام؟ بعد ما يخلص البلوك ده احتمال الشانل جين تتغير تاني فلازم أعمل استيميت جديد. فالست الجديدة هبعت معاها تريننج تاني واستيميت تاني وهكذا تمام؟